Brad received his BS and PhD from Montana State University, and he received a master's degree from the University of Idaho. He's worked for the Montana Department of Fish and Wildlife and Parks for nearly 30 years and has spent much of that time conserving native trout species by implementing conservation actions, conducting research, and coordinating conservation efforts across the state. Brad retired from Montana FWP in 2010 and began working with the Wildlife Conservation Society in 2011 as their senior aquatic scientist in their North America program, which actually is based in Bozeman. Brad's work is currently focused on the conservation of native fish in the greater Yellowstone and northern Rockies area. Welcome, Brad.
So I'm going to talk about prioritizing conservation Yellowstone cutthroat. These are my co-authors from USGS Northern Rockies, Montana Fish, Wildlife, and Parks, Idaho Fish and Game, Wyoming Fish and Game, and Jack Williams, Amy Haak from Trout Unlimited, and then Robin Knox from the Western Trout Initiative has been involved in this project. And what I'm going to talk about today, first I'm going to give you just a little background about the Wildlife Conservation Society, which is my organization. The Wildlife Conservation Society began in 1895 with the transfer of bison as their American bison as their initial conservation effort. It was started by folks in New York City, conservationists and philanthropists, people like Teddy Roosevelt. And they started as the New York Zoological Society. They've continued, and their global mission is to conserve wildlife and wild places, and you can read it as well as I can talk about it. But what I want to talk about is that we're a nonprofit organization that employs around 4,000 employees. We have over 200 PhD scientists and medical staff. We have 45 global conservation offices throughout the world, involved in over 500 conservation projects in about 65 different countries. And what we can offer is a really great network of conservation scientists and practitioners worldwide. I'm going to start by the acknowledgments, because this work has been supported by so many different people, and it's been made possible by the coordinated and collaborative effort of a lot of biologists and conservationists and land managers throughout this area. Primarily what we call the multi-state interagency Yellowstone Cutthroat Trout Conservation Work Group. It's a mouthful, and I'll just call it the work group from now on. But state agencies from all the states where Yellowstone cutthroat occur, Forest Service, BLM, Fish and Wildlife Service, Yellowstone Park, just a wide array of folks, and it involves both universities, private NGOs, government organizations, are all meet as part of this group. This group began about 20 years ago and then formally started meeting about 10 years ago. They have conducted Yellowstone cutthroat trout status assessments, which have set the stage for the conservation that's now occurring. Of course, the Great Northern has helped fund this project. Montana Fish, Wildlife, and Parks, Adam Peterson, is their GIS and information person. He maintains the database, and we're working very closely with him, both to use the data that's already been collected, but then also to put the data and the prioritization and criteria we're using for prioritization into this database. National Fish and Wildlife Foundation, Jackson Hole One Fly Foundation, has helped with some funding, particularly of the shield space and prioritization. So, Yellowstone cutthroat trout are a subspecies. There's 14 species that have been subspecies of cutthroat trout that have been recognized. This shows the distributions of the seven major subspecies of cutthroat trout in Western North America. And the area that Yellowstone occupy, or I've got my pointer on here, is this area here, and I'll show more on that later. If you look at this as to the Great Northern LCC outline is here in the blue dots, this red are the basins occupied by Yellowstone cutthroat trout, and the yellow are actually the streams historically occupied by Yellowstone cutthroat trout. And what you'll note on this map is that there are many different jurisdictions. It inhabits a relatively large landscape. It's not only in the Great Northern, but it spills over into the Great Basin and also into the prairie pothole landscapes. Yellowstone cutthroat trout can be a really good indicator of cold water ecosystems, particularly river, lake, and stream connections, because they inhabit all those types of waters. The fact that there is the existing work group has made this a good place to focus some initial efforts. This group has already identified many conservation opportunities for this subspecies throughout its range. And because of that, there's really a need for prioritization, because really there's way more conservation work to be done than we have resources to do. And it's very interesting because this prioritization needs to be done at scale too. So there are broad scale things that need to be done and may need more money, but there's also regional and local scale opportunities that we need to recognize. And so this is a way to kind of help allocate the resources we use for conservation. What the work group has done is they have broken the entire range. So the colored part of this map shows the entire range of Yellowstone cutthroat. And what the work group did is split this entire range up into four geographic management units, or GMUs. And throughout this range, Yellowstone cutthroat historically occupied about most of this basin, actually, but now they occupy about a little over 11,000 kilometers, and the historical occupancy shows up in this light gray, which is a little hard to see, but they now occupy about 11,600 kilometers, which is about 43% of that historical habitat that was occupied. And of that, those populations, and there's been a lot of work done surveying and assessing the genetic status of these populations. And about populations at about a little over 5,000 kilometers have actually been genetically tested and show no evidence of introgression with rainbow trout, which is one of the primary threats, or one of the major threats, to the persistence of Yellowstone cutthroat. So what was done here during this prioritization is essentially building off efforts the work group has already made. So this Yellowstone cutthroat work group has met, they meet annually as an entire group, and then these four GMU teams, which include the local biologists and the local folks, managers from each of these geographic areas, they usually meet at least once and sometimes twice a year on their own, and then they get together with representatives from all the GMU teams as a one large work group and meet usually in December, so meet annually. And through the assessment, the original assessments that were done initially in 2006, and then they're updated about every 5 years, the last formal update just occurred. And through those assessments, they've actually identified what they call conservation populations. And these are populations that these various entities have agreed they're going to work to conserve. And I'll talk more about that in a little bit. These conservation populations essentially have formed then the backbone. This was the initial prioritization. So that forms the backbone then of what we've started doing with this project. As an aside, the Yellowstone Cutthroat Work Group, since their inception about 20 years ago and their hard work, we've essentially, through these assessments, documented that we've pretty much stemmed the tide of decline in Yellowstone cutthroat because of all the hard work being done, and it hasn't been easy. But decadally, through about when Lewis and Clark arrived on the scene till about the 1960s or 70s, these fish were going through some severe declines each decade. We slowed that a little bit in the 70s and 80s, and now we've pretty much stopped it in the 2000s, which is really good news. So we go then from identifying these conservation populations, which, like I say, have been done, and then hierarchically we move through and prioritize now the basins that these occupy, and then within those basins start prioritizing individual populations. As we prioritize the individual populations, what we're doing is identifying the threats that those populations face, and we're actually going to rank those threats. And then, ultimately, the objective is to prioritize the actions needed and the funding needed to accomplish those actions so that we can hopefully affect policy as far as what gets funded and prioritize that actually by the people on the ground that are doing the work. So that's the objective here. So for the prioritization here, we start with the prioritization and then split. We have kind of two levels of prioritization that we're doing. One is an ecological side of things where we're looking at representation on the landscape, resilience, and redundancy, and I'll talk more about those in a second. And then what opportunities are there to actually do conservation? And that is what levels of support there are and what opportunities are there to expand and or secure populations. So I'm going to start with opportunity criteria because these criteria are the same for both the basin level and the population level. And so what we're trying to do in this opportunity is look for opportunities to reduce threats to existing conservation populations. And these tables are set up the same where we show on the left column kind of the goal, the middle column is the objectives, and then the right column are kind of the attributes that we can use to assess and actually set the criteria. So you can see under reduced threats that imminent threats can be mitigated or mediated by immediate action. We can take it, and then under objectives, take advantage of private landowner conservation, and then develop local regional support are the objectives, and you can read the attributes. So what we're interested in is it feasible to do conservation actions? And if it is, then what of those actions are likely to do the most good? Now I'm moving to ecological criteria, and these are the ecological criteria we've been using for the river basins. This was modified from an earlier paper by Haak and Williams. And kind of what they had were the three R's, which were on the left column there, representation, resilience, and redundancy. And from the basin point of view, we're looking at genetic diversity and genetic purity, or relative genetic purity. Life history diversity, so fish that may move between lakes and rivers and streams versus fish that may just reside as residents of small streams, for instance. We want to protect ecological diversity, unique traits. These may be coloring patterns. These may be behavioral traits. And these traits are harder to quantify in a large database, but local information can provide attributes for these traits. And so that shows kind of the representation part. The resilience part is to try and protect strongholds and these connected populations. You can see the attributes here. We actually have very specific lengths or areas of habitat we want occupied, either as one large metapopulation or with several. And then redundancy is having several populations or metapopulations with lots of different spawning areas or source areas. So I'm willing to pause there and for questions, if there's any questions, Mary.
Yeah, folks, if you have any quick questions, please type them in now in the questions pod on the right-hand side of the screen. Brad, we can wait a second or two, and it would be helpful if these questions were obviously relevant to the material that you just covered.
And I'd be happy to take questions later.
Yeah, we'll have questions too. And maybe we want to do that given the time thing. Nothing's popping in the queue.
Okay.
We could just wait till the end too if that works. Okay, thanks.
Okay, so the slide I have up now shows the entire historical range of cutthroat is the major outlined area in white. And then the bluer areas are the areas that were identified as high priority river basins. And the very light blue ones, we've actually, within the working group, talked about these came out as moderately high priority from opportunity point of view, but a lower priority from the ecological point of view. So these are going to drop out as basin priorities, and we're going to move into the population priority for those. So the dark blue areas are the basins right now that have come out as high priority basins. And what's really interesting is it makes sense from both an ecological and conservation point of view. As you can see, that these basins are in the core of the habitat, you know, along the Rocky Mountain spine. And if you look at the total number of basins in the range were 41 of these eight-digit HUCs. Eight of those are no longer occupied, okay? And 15 of these basins were ranked as high priority. And that's, you know, over 40% of the total number of basins. So this was kind of the first level of the prioritization, was at this river basin level. The other thing to note here, from a climate change point of view, is that these basins are along the spine of the Rocky Mountains, and so they may be, especially in the core of these, more resilient to climate change than maybe some of the other areas. If you look at the actual data for these basins, and what I have on this slide is the GMU areas are on the bottom, Bighorn Wind, Lower Snake, etc. And then the actual basin names are the vertical names there. And then what it shows is the kilometers of occupied habitat by conservation populations, with the red ones being the high priorities and the blue ones being not high priorities. And here I need to make a statement. The work group and all the GMU teams, as we've gone through this, have been adamant, and we all agree, there's consensus that none of these populations are really throwaway. So they all are a high priority. What we're talking about now is just where we want to put resources and lots of additional resources to secure what we have. If you'll notice, a couple of the two basins, the South Forks Shoshone and the Upper Henrys, those were the two light colored ones, this one and this one, and these now have dropped off as high priority. So if we look at this, and this slide's a little busy, but I'm going to explain what's going on. So each of the different four plots are the different GMUs. We have the different basins, and then each of the different colors in these stacked bar charts represent individual conservation populations. And so what you can see here is that most of these high priority basins have what we'd call metapopulations, or populations that occupy large chunks of habitat in terms of stream miles or stream kilometers. And all the top priority ones have a one above them. And again, this South Fork Shoshone and Upper Henrys are likely to drop out. Another thing to note is in the Upper Snake GMU in the lower left, those were all considered high priority. And the main thing to look at here is that within each of these high priority basins, we have at least one or two large interconnected metapopulations. I'll talk a little more about that later when I talk about threats. Whoops. So now we're moving to the individual population criteria. There are 305 individual conservation populations that were identified in the assessment. And the ecological criteria for these populations have been modified a little bit from the basin ones in that now we're dealing with a particular population. And so representation's pretty similar, except number three there, protection of geographic ecological diversity. You'll see now that we might have a population that may not occupy a high priority basin. But if it's the only population that occupies a peripheral river basin, so in the periphery of the range, you may have only one population left, that's likely to receive a high priority because of its peripheral nature. And usually these peripheral populations are where the evolutionary history has acted and maybe locally adapted and have actually really changed, and we want to conserve that diversity. For resilience, it's pretty much the same, except I've got number three here. We've actually included as a qualitative measure that population's resistance to climate change, and I'll talk about that here in a minute. And then redundancy, the fact of the matter is the population is or is not a metapopulation. And then what level or what number of connected tributaries or number of isolated populations do we want to have? Right now, five in this, the number five over here in this lower right is in red. That hasn't been agreed upon by the whole work group. That's just been thrown out by mainly the folks doing the study right now, and we've been in discussion with GMU teams about this, but that has not yet been agreed to by the entire work group. So that's a draft and a tentative recommendation. So where are we in this process from prioritizing individual populations? Well, there's 305 populations. We've completed the prioritization criteria assessments for 224 of these populations. And the table in the upper left of this shows by a GMU how many populations we've actually prioritized in each GMU. And the red on this figure shows the conservation populations. We still need to go through with the GMU teams and take these conservation priority criteria and actually then assign them to tiers in the prioritization effort. But for right now, we're moving along pretty well and have a lot of these populations actually prioritized. If you look at this on an individual basin, and we're generally doing this on a sub-basin by sub-basin level, and so what I wanted to show you was the Shields Basin. And again, we're not saying that any of these populations aren't worth preserving. And ecologically, there's some that are really important that we really want to maintain. And then opportunity-wise, some we can do something about and some we might not be able to, but we want to preserve them. So the way this worked out is the red is a large interconnected population of the Yellowstone Cutthroat and the Shield. The Shields is somewhat unique in that our threats from non-native, potentially hybridizing species such as rainbow are relatively low. We've actually isolated the Shields at the bottom end of that red. So in the bottom part of the red down in here, we've actually, Fish, Wildlife, and Parks, in collaboration with a lot of folks, have built, reconstructed an irrigation diversion that was there that did serve as a barrier to rainbow trout invading this basin and prevented their invasion. And that barrier has been beefed up here recently to remain a barrier. And so in the state of Montana's plan calls for this to be a core conservation area for Yellowstone cutthroat because of that. And so that entire population of above that barrier, connected population above that barrier, is rated as a top priority. You can see here this green is a second tier. This is a population that there's lots of opportunities potentially to conserve and or expand that population. Then we have several populations that are a third tier. These are isolated. They're actually, most of these populations are isolated in areas where the threats are really not very imminent and or even present. And so these populations were given a third tier. And kind of the strategy on these populations is more of a monitoring to watch and be sure they persist. But actions are limited and the opportunities to do actions limited. And then this other is a connected population to the main Yellowstone River that wasn't assessed during this assessment. So how are we going to bring climate change? And I apologize for this figure is not real clear, but I think it shows what we need to show. So these panels in this chart, the upper two rows, show decadal changes in water temperatures with some predictive models and air temperature water data, and then air temperature water temperature models, showing, say, 1900 to 1909 in the upper left, the Dust Bowl years in the 1930s in the middle of that upper panel, and then 1970 to 79, and then we go each decade from 70-79 through 2000 to 2009. And then the lower three panels show predicted climate changes with different climate prediction models in the decade 2050 to 2059. And what this shows is a couple of interesting things. First of all, the decade from 2000 to 2010 was similar and worse, actually, in most sites to the Dust Bowl years of the 1930s, 39, and that things are going to get worse from a stream temperature point of view. And this was taken from work that Al-Chokhachy and we did, and it's published in 2013. And so we plan to use this type of modeling along with Dan Isaac's work out of the U.S. Forest Service Rocky Mountain Station and his colleagues with their predictive water temperature models to then help us prioritize and put this prioritization kind of in the context of climate change. And the other interesting thing we can do with this data is look at kind of a quantitative assessment of that through using these models and GIS and the assessment database and compare that to the more qualitative assessment that's being done by the biologists and managers at the ground level through this prioritization effort. And so that'll be part of this process. So I talked a little bit about the metapopulations and the long lengths of habitats these metapopulations occupied. I now want to talk about the downside or the some of the difficulties in dealing with those metapopulations. These metapopulations most often are what we call mixed fish populations, and so, and in some cases mixed stock, where we have pure cutthroat or nearly pure cutthroat, Yellowstone cutthroat, but they're co-occurring with rainbow trout and maybe hybrids. And what we've been finding with climate change, or with at least the changing situation in the environment, is that reproductive isolation for these various segments of these populations, in other words, the pure Yellowstone cutthroat versus the hybrids versus the rainbow, seem to be breaking down. The isolation mechanism was primarily a timing mechanism that was triggered by flow and temperature cues. And these mechanisms appear to be breaking down. And it's a very large concern because this shows the species and percent by length of what these species are impacting on existing conservation populations. And so non-native salmonids are one of the primary threats right now to the conservation of Yellowstone cutthroat trout. And these, particularly in these large interconnected metapopulations. And so in the world of conserving native salmonids, the native trout of the inland west, we're kind of in this catch-22 where we need to isolate, maybe over the short term, to protect these populations from invasion by non-natives to preserve them. But we will also want connectivity to allow ecological processes to occur and to maintain their resiliency in a connected landscape. And so this is a real catch-22 in conservation of native inland salmonids. And the answer, I think, is we need to do both. And so we'll be talking more about that as we move through this. But it's really interesting here. If you look at the two species to the left, brook trout first and then rainbow trout, brook trout seem to primarily threaten the smaller headwater populations. They don't occur in these larger river systems as much in the rivers and the larger streams, whereas the rainbow trout and brown trout, the next two, primarily occur in these valley bottom rivers and larger streams. And so we've got this kind of dichotomy in how these non-native salmonids affect Yellowstone cutthroat trout. If you look at hybridization itself, this shows the threat, the hybridization risk for the conservation populations, for the designated conservation population. And less than a quarter of the existing conservation populations are deemed at no risk of hybridization. And over a quarter, and these are mainly those metapopulations, those larger connected populations, actually are sympatric with hybridizing species. And then another greater than a quarter have hybridizing species less than 10 kilometers away, and so essentially knocking on the doorstep. So we've got to deal with this threat from non-native species. So the conclusions so far, and as I said when I first began this presentation, this is a work in progress, must be considered draft right now. We will be going to the work group in December and presenting what we've gotten to date and hopefully get some agreements and consensus on buy-off on where we're going. But we don't have... We don't have much disagreement on these conclusions. First of all, we need to prioritize conservation across a species' entire range. If we're doing species conservation, we need to evaluate that across the entire range, especially as we're doing this prioritization. We have to have the managers involved, the field-level folks. They're the ones that know what's going on. They're the ones that are going to have to implement this stuff, and they're the ones that really are responsible for doing this. We need to apply some consistent criteria or at least a consistent framework with well-documented rationales for our prioritization. We're finding that a hierarchical process seems to be the most useful for us in this process, where we go from river basin to population to actions. We right now are done with the river basins. We'll be done with populations probably this year. We've identified the threats. We haven't prioritized those yet. And then we'll be doing prioritization of actions. The way we envision this occurring is at the river basin scale, we probably won't need to repeat prioritization of these basins very frequently, if at all. The population prioritization, we may need to do some minor adjustments on a 3 to 5 year frequency, but by and large, those will be prioritized. What will change there more than likely is opportunities, but actions will probably have to go through and prioritize actions on an annual basis. And we hope we do that through the GMU teams, and we hope then that the funding sources that fund these things will listen to the folks on the ground and use the priorities developed by this team then to actually fund the actions that are proposed. And the third one, and again, this was pretty much agreed upon by the entire work group, that currently non-native species represent one of the biggest threats to cutthroat throughout their range. And this kind of has created a little bit of a problem because many, especially of the national funding sources to do restoration and conservation, aren't real plugged in yet to that maybe this is what we have to deal with at a high priority. And so this is, I think, an area that we need to work on. All right, I'll stick up the acknowledgement slide and then take questions.
Okay, Brad, we do have a couple questions in the queue. I want to remind folks, please type in your question, or if you prefer, you're welcome to ask a question via phone. I think all you need to do is right-click on your name in that attendee list and raise your hand, and then I can unmute you. But we'll start with questions, the typed-in questions. So, Brad, this is a question from Helen. I understand the essential focus on climate-resilient regions, i.e. core habitat, but does your current prioritization truly capture any known genetic diversity found in the more peripheral populations?
Yes, and that is why we actually have that as a criteria for those individual population criteria. And yes, there is genetic diversity that shows up out there from some of the genetic sampling. And yes, it is a priority, but I think the understanding is going to be it may be harder to conserve those with under a changing climate than those more at the core. And so climate is just one portion of the equation, but I think we need to acknowledge that climate may make conserving these peripheral populations more difficult if it changes like we think it's going to.
Okay, we have a question from Rick. What about lake trout impact on Yellowstone cuts?
It's definitely an impact, and it's definitely a high priority. We've recognized that population as a high priority population within that GMU. So, I don't know what else to say about it. I'm not sure that the lake trout will drive that population to extinction. I hope not, but we don't know at this point. But it's definitely an impact. There's just no doubt about it.
Here's another question from Rick. How has forest practices and grazing affected stream temps?
So there are data out there that suggests they can affect stream temperatures. During some of our threat identification, we have identified some land management practice, some areas that may be more impacted by land management practices. We have not prioritized those yet. It kind of totally depends on the practice, so it's very landscape specific, context specific on where you are. But yes, it has the potential to influence stream temperature, absolutely.
All right, we have a question from Mike. In regards to Yellowstone cutthroat trout range-wide trends discussed in the beginning of your presentation, has a map been produced that shows the extent of pure Yellowstone cutthroat trout without the presence of non-natives?
Yes, this is one amazing thing actually about this assessment database that is being kept by Montana. And generally what the states do is split up the subspecies and different states house the data for different subspecies, and Montana houses the data for Yellowstones. And this database is all GIS linked. It's an access database linked to a GIS, so it's all a GIS queryable database. So there's tons of stuff you can do with it. I mean, if we had time, I could bring it up and show you some stuff. But yes, you can absolutely show whatever you want, essentially. Whatever query you want to do, you can show it.
Great. And there's one more question from Wade. Virtually everywhere we look, it's non-native species as the single largest threat. When are we going to recognize and prioritize them as such and begin to deal with it systematically?
So that's a great question, Wade. And I actually brought this up at the Western Division AFF meeting. I think the Western Division, and if you want to help, Wade, I'll draft you. We've been asked to write a position draft position statement for the American Fisheries Society on this. I think it's something that we're going to need to start affecting policy on, especially funding. And the Yellowstone Work Group has recognized this. And as a matter of fact, at our last meeting last December, this was a major issue for that group. And so I agree, it's something we got to deal with. And Wade, if you want to help, drop me an email if you want to help on drafting that position statement.
Another question came in from Robin. Will the results or the draft be presented at the Wild Trout Symposium could be helpful in getting this prioritization process applied to other native trouts with a large geographic distribution.
Yeah, Robin, we received lots of interest in this from various groups. We kind of don't want to ourselves expand too much until we've got a product here. We hope to get one publication out next fall, at least on the basin side of things. But yes, I've planned on submitting this for both the Yellowstone Park Biennial Conference and probably Wild Trout. I don't know whether I'll present or Robert or someone else, but I think someone will present this at those.
All right. We do have another question. We keep popping in. Jonathan asks, can you talk a little bit about what kinds of actions you expect and who will take them? Also, whether there are things to stop doing as well as things to do.
Okay, for things to do, we have a huge list that actually for those of you that are interested in this, I think getting the last assessment update will help because we actually started listing the types of actions and how many actions are being done. But the actions I'll give you examples of are barrier installation or removal, depending on the circumstance. Removal of non-natives, refounding populations and habitats that were vacant and or vacated by removing non-natives, habitat enhancement type projects, just a whole host of things are being done. And if you want a more complete list, you can get the five-year update, which is a 2013 document on the assessment.
Right, Brad, that looks like it's the last question, and which is good timing-wise, considering the challenges we had at the beginning. Brad, I'd like to thank you for your presentation, as well as I'd like to thank the audience for persevering with us and sticking with it.